Crappie has become king in Mississippi. Larry Pugh is here with us. We're going to be talking about that with him. Adam Butler here as well as Major Chris Reed, who was not with us last week because he was out training cadets.
It's good to be back.
Yeah, so
good
tell
to
me
see
what,
all your shining faces this
tell me,
morning.
Tell me what was going. How's that going out there at Makota?
We're doing good. It's always fun to get a new class started, a new batch, you know, if you will. Kind of preparing to come out into the field, and we're laying the groundwork. You know, we're in week two, and we're just progressing. We're actually going to be taking them and kind of into Larry Pugh's world this week. Mm-hmm. in some real world scenario stuff. We're going to expose them to a little crappie fishing enforcement and the madness that comes in April to our reservoirs in North Mississippi.
And teaching
they won't be working. They'll just be observing.
They'll be watching it.
Field trip. Taking a field trip.
Well, they get the firsthand, hands-on knowledge, which seems to do well for them as far as retention of stuff. You know, it's one thing to sit in the classroom and get told about this and do these type of scenarios here and there, but it's quite another to go out there and actually, you know, see it on paper in the real world. So it's good. It's good, good, good.
And I imagine with this warm weather coming, we got another warm week. If I had to guess, I imagine they're out there out and about all over these waterways today with it being in the lower 70s today.
That's why we're here, JT. Mm-hmm. It's been incredible the last 2 weeks, the number of anglers I've seen on our reservoirs. And I'm not just talking about the Big Four, but statewide.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're going to get into that first. Got to get a turkey game check here as we wind her down with Adam Butler. Where do we stand, and what do we expect for the final 2 weeks?
Well, JT, we're looking at about, like you said, about two more weeks. We're going to May the 1st. As of just a couple of moments ago, there had been 9,717 turkeys
gracious
checked into the game check system, which we're still really, really proud of how it's all going. Very few issues. We've accommodated hunters as those have come up, but really it's been surprisingly few how many complaints and technical difficulties and that sort of thing. Almost none of that, really. So we're tickled with it. The next couple of weeks for those turkey hunters still after them should be really good. You know, days like today where the weather's great, and as the hens start going to nest, the gobblers will get a little more desperate and should be some of those birds that have been frustrating and difficult to call will all of a sudden start running in. So
a temperature check across the state, are they where they need to be? Are they a little late? Are they still maybe a week or two behind schedule?
I think my gauge of it is they're about where they need to be. I've heard a lot of people still dealing with birds that are really henned up, but you know, we had a great hatch across a lot of the state last summer, and so you've got a lot of juvenile hens out there, and those young of the year birds are going to be later to nest anyway. So it could just be that's what's going on, you know. But what I'm hearing is positive, and like I said, I've always maintained that, you know, the last couple of weeks you get around, you know, somewhere around April 15th to April 20th in there till the end can just be phenomenal. You know,
so don't hang it up now.
Oh, by no means, by no means.
So you're saying don't put the shotgun up to get the boat out just yet?
Not just yet.
You can get the shotgun
now,
out.
Larry
may disagree.
Get the shotgun out in the morning, the boat out in the afternoon.
That'd be a good plan.
Or maybe boat in the morning and afternoon hunting. You could strike one
up folks,
now.
Hey, folks, talking about the game check, don't forget the game check contest is still open. One lucky person's going to win a Benelli Super Black Eagle 3 Turkey Edition. Provided by the foundation at Dad's Super Pond, located in Gulfport. You got a couple of things you need to do in order to enter the contest. First, you need to like MDWFP.com's Facebook page, and then you need to like the official contest post, then complete the registration form at the link provided in the post. And all this information can be found at MDWFP.com/gamecheck under additional information. Also, like to thank the Foundation for Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks and Dad's Super Pond for helping us promote the new game check system that is so important. Obviously, we expanded the North CWD Management Zone, probably the biggest expansion we've seen so far. With that, more public meetings, I'm sure a lot of people wanting a lot of answers to a lot of questions, and that's why you guys are going about doing this, right?
Right, JT, and it's worthwhile to mention that we have, you know, I know people probably aren't thinking about deer season yet, but we are at the MDWFP, and so We've got some public meetings coming up. I'm going to be in one of those will be in kind of that new part of the North Zone. So we've got on April the 22nd, there will be a CWD public meeting in Batesville at the Batesville Civic Center. On April the 30th here in Jackson, there will be one at the Mississippi Museum of Natural Science. And on May the 7th, down in South Mississippi at the Forest County Mississippi State University Extension office there, kind of the southern part of Hattiesburg there. All of these will start at 6 p.m., and they're going to talk about kind of where we stand with CWD. They're going to talk about the zone expansions, like you mentioned, and they're going to talk about any potential season changes or changes to regulations that will impact the 2019-2020 deer season coming up. And some of that, so we the commission is meeting this week in April. The April commission meeting is traditionally the meeting of the year in which we propose changes to hunting regulations, most hunting regulations. So may have some things coming out of that that we can discuss next week. But all of that will be covered at these meetings. So, again, that's April 22nd in Batesville, April 30th in Jackson, and May the 7th in Hattiesburg. And if people want to see more, that announcement is on our website. They can go check out all that out. We encourage them to come out and get plugged in.
All right, Larry Pugh, it is it. This is time. This is the, what is it, the old song, the most wonderful time of the year. They play around Christmas time, but for you, spring and crappie fishing in Mississippi, and I'm sure the reports are pretty strong right now, aren't they?
We have been getting them for the last 6 weeks, JT, but I would say the last 2 weeks, it's really peaked. Whether you're fishing up in the north part of the state or through the central part or even through South Mississippi may be a little ahead of us. But, you know, I was on Ross Barnett last Wednesday, and then I got another report this morning that you can't find a place to park at Tommy's out on the reservoir, that the traffic's out there. And if the folks are there, they're there for a reason. So we've gotten some really good reports from the flood control reservoirs up north. We've got some fish that are still spawning, some that are post-spawn. So those that want to catch crappie shallow or white perch where I grew up, you still got some time to get out there and get after it.
So how shallow are we talking about?
It depends. But typically, you know, crappie will spawn in shallow water. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking 2 to 3 foot, even less than that in some cases. You know, those nests, those eggs need sunlight for them to hatch successfully, so they're going to be looking for shallow areas to spawn. Once they're through spawning, they'll start moving back offshore. That's really the only time that you're going to find crappie, particularly white crappie, in shallow water for the most part, and they'll move into what we call post-spawn and then into their start setting up in their summer pattern. And the anglers have gotten good at finding these fish no matter what time of the year it is.
What is a question off subject here? I know obviously the was not off subject, but we've been talking about the Ross, Ross Barnett being lowered. Y'all been trying to take care of the Salvinia.
Sure.
How is that affecting it right now as far as the water level at the Ross Barnett and the crappie?
It's still down.
Yeah.
And what we saw last week when we were out on the water was that the fish are still shallow. They're moving shallow and trying to do their thing, but they may not be in areas that you've historically caught them because the water's just not the depth that it normally is for April 15th or the 1st of April. So they're still going to spawn. They're going to spawn a little bit deeper. We watched several boats successfully capture some very nice fish in a little bit similar areas, but just out a little bit deeper. The boat was probably in 4 to 5 feet of water, so similar type habitat, but just in a little deeper water.
Well, and of course, obviously, Ross Barnett is very popular for there's other lakes too, though, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I get asked that all the time. You know, hey, I want to go crappie fishing. I want to come crappie fishing. Where do I need to go? You know, we have the nationally known flood control reservoirs up in the north part of the state, Sardisine at Grenada and Arkabutla. But obviously, in the Delta, Lake Washington is one of the best. Ross Barnett Reservoir, Pickwick Lake in the northeast, and Okeechobee gets overlooked. In the east central part of the state, in the east part of the state.
Where is Okeechobee?
Just outside Meridian.
Well, we'll talk about that. We'll also talk about the flood control reservoirs, and we're talking some crappie with you today here on Mississippi Outdoors Radio. As always, brought to you by the Foundation for Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks. Super Talk Mississippi, the Monday edition. We've got more coming up.
Hey, gun enthusiasts. Never heard of the Benelli Super Black Eagle 3? Well, it's a top-of-the-line shotgun, and here's how to get yours free. Go to Facebook and like the Mississippi Department of Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks Facebook page. Then, like the official Game Check contest post on our page. And then complete the registration form at the link provided. Check out ndwfp.com/gamecheck for more information. Thanks to the Wildlife Foundation and Dad's Super Pawn, South Mississippi's top gun store in Gulfport.
Is there age limit on becoming a wildlife officer, Major Reed?
Yes, there is. You must be 21 years of age prior to applying and have 64 college credit hours. Not area specific in criminal justice, but you do have to have 64 hours of college credit, and you need to be 21 years of age.
And isn't there? There's a path at Mississippi State, a major, to becoming a conservation officer.
Yeah, we have a conservation law. We have hired a few people in the past who have gone that route, and it just kind of helps lay a groundwork and a base. And you know, it's a good time if you think you may want to do something like that, and you start taking some of those courses, and you swap your major during college when you decide you don't want to do it, and it would, you know, maybe be something good to figure out on the front end.
All right, Larry P., let's get down to it. MDWFP, we talked about the fact that we've been managing crappie. That started way back in the 80s, didn't it?
Yeah, JT, is something I'm pretty proud of. We were one of the first agencies, or the first agency, to lead the way in utilizing, you know, the size limits we have in place now, reduced creel limits, and even pole limits. And some of the other agencies have been late coming to the party, per se. But we were the first ones to put some of those in place to try to protect and manage the crappie resources that we have. And despite all the dire predictions of using these tools that we've had, we've continued to maintain good growth rates, and certainly angler participation has never declined.
And the we were the first ones to put the slots in there, right?
Right, a minimum length limit. Mm-hmm. We started with a 10-inch, and then, you know, went with 11, and now we're at 12 inches and a reduced bag limit. And all of these changes to regs, I know a lot of folks were frustrated over the last 20 years with having to learn them and get used to them. But, you know, these were put in place for a reason, and we're constantly monitoring, making sure that they're doing having their intended purpose.
So the question is, I mean, or we go back to this, and anytime y'all make a change, or anybody or any change is ever made, that's all we're ever going to hear about is how dire and terrible, and it's just y'all going, you know, it's all messed up. That's normal. That we go through that all the time.
And we still get that, whether it's, I would say, wildlife or even on the fish side.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I tell folks now that we would have a harder time taking those regulations off than we would leaving them alone. More people would be upset if we removed them.
Mm-hmm. So what are the rules as far as, you know, when we're talking about the ability to go? I know we see these boats now. I see these boats where they troll. They've got all these big rigs, and what they may have. I guess they're getting to is, what's the limit on the poles?
Well, it's four poles per person.
Mm-hmm.
And we use a variety of tools. Management tools. You mentioned the minimum length limit. We mentioned the reduced bag limit. But we have, you know, a lot of different tools in place that we can use. And pole limits was one of the first things we put in place on those flood control reservoirs. And I like to use the analogy of duck hunting. You know, when people go duck hunting, how many shells can you use, Major Reed?
Three.
Your gun. All that does is control harvest. It mm-hmm. slows harvest.
Mm-hmm.
And by putting a pole restriction on it, what we're trying to do is slow harvest down in terms of how fast you catch your limit. And folks were getting out there back in the day, you know, a pontoon boat, they might have 25 poles on it if they're trolling. And I've personally seen that many poles out. And obviously, we've got the data that shows the more poles you fish, the more fish you catch.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason we instituted those pole limits.
See, you know, I've never done that trolling stuff. Time I've ever crappie fish, you get out there with a bunch of minnows and a
right.
Well, that's how we all probably
sure,
started.
Sure,
sure.
You know what happens if I was on a pontoon boat with 25 fishing poles at one time,
bird's nest,
it turned into a big mess quick.
Bird's nest.
Is there a size limit on crappie on the Barnett and the spillway?
There is not.
There is not.
Not statewide.
The question says why. That's the question. Why not?
Why not?
Yes.
We manage those crappie populations lake specific, and we get a lot of questions: is why is there not a size limit on Barnett? Well, the first thing we look at is growth rate. How fast do these fish grow? When we talk about Barnett, Eagle and the flood control reservoirs, these fish are growing so fast on those lakes that they're getting harvested before they had a chance to reproduce. Common sense.
Hmm.
So at Barnett, those fish don't grow as fast. So what we'd end up doing if we put a length limit on Barnett, those fish would stockpile. In other words, if we had a 10-inch, which or 12-inch, like everybody wants, we'd end up with a bunch of 10-inch fish that nobody could take home because they just don't grow fast enough.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a question.
Okay.
So the other ones you mentioned are on better, more fertile dirt,
yep.
right?
Yep.
They're in the delta. Mm-hmm. They're in places where you can grow a lot of crops.
Yep.
Barnett is not. Is that
That's
the reason?
Great. Good dirt, good habitat.
Good dirt equals
yep.
good fish.
Good fishing, good productivity.
All right. Sardis, Enid, Grenada Lake, the big four. We talk about what Sardis, Grenada, Enid, and what is it, Arco Butler?
Yeah.
These are nationally known places to catch fish, mm-hmm. and that's huge for the state of Mississippi, isn't it?
You know, and I know this is a little bit dated, JT, but I still fall back to it in terms of some economic data we collected or actually we worked with a firm to collect back in 2008. And keep in mind that, yes, it is now 11 years old, but 11 years ago, the crappie fishery at Sardis alone was worth about $23.4 million to the state of Mississippi. Now, what does that mean? Well, that includes all your trip-related expenses, gas, food, lodging, and that's what a lot of people don't take into account. So when the average crappie party or crappie angler spends about $160 per trip, counting everything, and I'm not an economics person, but they quickly do these multipliers, and you're talking about $23.4 million and 283 full and part-time jobs just throughout the state. And that number's not gone down for the folks that are listening that have fished, you know, Grenada and Sardis. It's not changed. And matter of fact, I would argue we've got more people fishing now than we did in 08. Mm-hmm. So crappie's big business, and we're continually seeing it get bigger.
It's is out there. Got a couple of questions. Are there crappie guides? Yep, there are crappie guides.
Yes, there is.
They will take you and put you on the fish.
Particularly on the flood control reservoirs that mm-hmm. we keep mentioning. There's some on Lake Washington, and that's the only place that I'm familiar with it. We do list some of those services on our website.
Someone said, is the Sardis Waterfowl Refuge a WBMA now? People are wading and hunting all over it on Sardis. Also, is it legal to clean crappie at a boat ramp? Saw two Missouri boats and one Illinois boat doing this with short fish. Can't measure a fillet. Thanks, guys. Keep up the good work.
Okay.
A couple of good questions in there.
I can't answer the waterfowl or WMA refuge. I'm not familiar with that. I know that you can't wade on the refuge at Sardis, and you can clean your fish at the boat ramp. What you cannot do is clean your fish on the water. The law says those fish must remain whole and intact while on the water, where length limits are put in place or are in place. So if those crappie guides that you're seeing are cleaning short fish at the boat ramp, yes, they can clean them, but I would encourage you to call.
Yeah, call 1-800.
Be smart
and report it. We work it. I mean,
yes.
We work it diligently, those reservoirs, to try to ensure that doesn't happen. We don't catch everybody, obviously, or we'd go out of the need for a job. And that's in any type of law enforcement. You can't catch all the bad guys. But so if somebody's out there kind of wondering, because everybody likes to ask why these days. It seems like that's their favorite question. So why can they clean them at the boat ramp? And somebody may say, well, it stinks it up, or it makes it nasty around the shore. Is there any
Well, just like the, you know, once they get on land and take that boat out,
right?
You know, that would be, you know,
it's equivalent to going duck hunting and coming back to
on the water. We got issues,
right?
Just for that same reason, you get checked on the water, we can't tell how long a fillet is. You get checked on the ramp, you know, you should be have those fish, or you can't clean those fish when officers check you there at the boat ramp.
All right, Mr. Pugh, you are in the spotlight today. Crappie fishing. You've been, it's hard to believe, but just over the past 20 years, about how long you've been in this position here, about as long as I've been in my position here, talk about the changes that we've seen over the just the last 20 years and how this has gone about.
Well, you know, you and I mentioned earlier, you know, we've come a long way from the cane pole, cork and minnow days back in the 60s and 70s, and
which was awesome.
How we used to fish for white perch, aka crappie. Mm-hmm. But a few of the things that I like to talk about when I get the chance to speak about the crappie fishing and where we've come is diehard crappie anglers are mobile. You know, when we talk about lakes, we used to historically think, well, I'm going to go camp at Lake Washington, and that's where I'm going to fish. Mm-hmm. No. If they get wind that the fish are biting at Grenada, boom, they're gone. If they get wind the fish are biting at Eagle, boom, they're gone. We heard last year all these fish were coming out of Grenada and are being caught last spring at Grenada, and we started doing some checking and fact-checking and following and some other things and found out they were being caught at Lake Washington. So crappie anglers are really mobile. Driving 2 to 3 hours now, once you've started on one lake, it doesn't mean anything. Secondly, gosh, man, 20 years. Look how far we've come with communication. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking, when we first got cell phones, well, that improved communication right now. And anglers talk. Crappie anglers, bass anglers, what'd you catch them on? Where'd you catch them? What lake are you fishing? And throw social media now into that with Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Instant communication. You caught a limit of fish at Eagle Lake and you want to post it on social media, instantly everybody knows you caught them and where you caught them. So communication has greatly improved.
That's a little different than the turkey hunters, Larry. The turkey hunters, communication, they're not so much.
That's right. They don't want anybody to know.
That's right. My buddies and I, we use code words and stuff. You know, we don't even
I like that.
Locations or no-nos.
You know, we talk about technology, JT, with depth finders now, GPS, trolling motors, power poles, the things that anglers have at their that they have the ability to use now to find fish.
You know, those boats, you know, that once were classified as a bass boat aren't necessarily just for bass fishing now.
No.
I mean, those quote-unquote bass boats with 250s on the back and two power poles on each side, you see those rigs getting pulled down the highway with spider rigs on the side, and that's their crappie rig.
That's right.
And that's a long way from a John boat, a paddle, and a bucket of minnows.
Yep.
It has certainly changed, hasn't it?
It really has, JT. And you couple that with the ability for anglers to find fish, for ability anglers to have the ability to effectively harvest fish. Plus, we crappie fished in usually March and April.
Yeah,
and then we didn't crappie fish anymore. It's 12 months a year now. Mm-hmm. It is 12 months a year. So when these fish move offshore after spawning, you know, anglers are using these electronics to find them and different techniques, whether it's trolling, pulling, you name it. They've come up with a different – I've seen them use planer boards like they do in the Great Lakes to get crankbaits down to the depth that those crappie are holding at.
They figured it out.
It's pretty cool. And so that's why we're trying to be really aggressive with some of the length regulations and creel limits that we have in place to protect this valuable resource.
That's good. That's where I was going to take my next question, is what the department has done to respond to this increased pressure and these changes that we've talked about.
Well, you know, our staff, we have a wonderful group of biologists that spend a lot of time collecting data. And I'll give it to Dr. Polis and our commission. We make sound recommendations based on science, and we have a lot of data that we collect out there, whether it's actually putting our hands on fish and getting lengths and weights and releasing them, to interviewing anglers, where we go up and say, you know, how many? What time did you start? What time did you stop? How many did you catch? Let me see your fish, by the way, so we can make sure they're of the correct size. So we get that data. We look at growth rates. So we just don't haphazardly say, oh, let's just put a 12-inch, 15-fish limit on Grenada. I mean, we think these through. We use models to put data in, and those models will actually predict how the fish population should respond based on all the data that we've collected.
All right, is there a size limit on the 10-tom now, crappie-wise?
It always has been a size limit on the 10-tom from Pickwick Lake all the way down to Aliceville in Mississippi, of 9-inch minimum length limit.
Do crappies shrink when you put them on ice?
I think all fish shrink, bass or crappie, when you put them on ice. Did we say something funny, Butler?
Is there a price of a senior's license, and what does it cover?
Senior exempt license would be a $5 license that they can purchase that would benefit the agency. It's also good for the senior. They have something easy to keep up with, show us. It's good. Good to go.
Back to that Sardis Refuge WMA question. Wanted to know if there was someone they could call to find out more information.
And they're wanting to know what, JT, about duck hunting?
They were wanting to know if it's a waterfowl refuge now because he sees people wading and hunting out there.
We've gotten those questions, and I want to make sure they call the Wildlife Bureau on that, JT. There seems to be some question as to whether or not you can actually wade in that refuge with the water up. Water's up, people are wading. Mm-hmm. And I don't think you can wade in that refuge, but I would encourage them to call.
You're talking wading to fish?
Yeah, they're wading for crappie.
JT, I would suggest that they call the Wildlife Bureau at 601-432-2199. And it just so happens our guy who is over that area is in the office today, so they can probably catch him and talk to him firsthand.
All right, and of course we go back to this, and there's different regulations on every different lake, and the reason why is because there's different situations, right, Larry?
Sure. You know, when you're talking about, 1.3 million angler hours annually, that's a lot of freaking fishing pressure, JT. That's a lot of folks out there. We go back to what we talked about. We use all the tools that we can available to us. And whether it's a 12-inch minimum on the flood control reservoirs, we put an 11-inch minimum length limit in place at Lake Washington and Eagle Lake. And people say, well, why did you put an 11? Well, because we saw no difference in how the population would respond between an 11 and a 12. So if there's no difference, let's go with the lower number to give the anglers the benefit of the doubt. So we want to err on the side of caution or err on the side of protect the resource, but we also want to help the anglers out when we can.
Well, and we've been talking an awful lot about this all, and the crappie has become the king here in Mississippi. This is something that we are truly something we can be proud of that we have here, and the fact that we are nationally known for this, and I think that's pretty cool, some really positive Mississippi for us.
You know, probably in the last 10 years, we've seen more specifically in the last 5 years, we've seen crappie tournaments just really blow up. And obviously, these national crappie organizations, where do they want to come fish? They want to go to the best crappie lakes. I know Grenada and Ross Barnett have hosted national championships. We're seeing an increase in the number of crappie tournaments in the state. Now, we're not yet there. We're not there yet where bass tournaments are. In terms of the numbers of the popularity. But we've even got staff now that are collecting data from the tournaments. It's just a good source of information, the kind of stuff that we collect from the crappie tournaments. You know, the average crappie weighed in last year was almost 1.4 pounds. That's a big fish, by the way. Yeah. People say, looking at crappie tournaments, if you want to go catch numbers, Ross Barnett Reservoir led the way. Pounds, Eagle Lake led the way. I like to think of limits like bass limits. A 7-fish limit for the entire state weighed, on average, a little over 12 pounds. That's strong for crappie. That is strong.
All right, Larry Pugh, appreciate it very much.
Thank you, JT.
Enjoy the crappie show, my friend. Now what we need to do is just, we should have had some for lunch, or either
took the words out of my mouth.
Or we should have gone and go get some for supper tonight.
A little fried crappie.
A little field trip crappie.
That's the best way. What's the best way to cook crappie? Fried up.